Good evening. Bonsoir à vous tous et je remercie tous ceux qui nous ont rejoints ce soir. C'est un public diversifié avec des responsabilités économiques, publiques, aussi monétaires pour ceux qui viennent de la Banque de France. Nous apprécions d'avoir ce public ce soir autour de notre hôte. Alors je vais passer à l'anglais puisque ça sera la langue de travail, si j'ose dire, pendant cette conférence, mais vous avez normalement tous une traduction. Et n'hésitez pas ensuite à poser vos questions en français. Elles seront aussi traduites. Dear Tarman, I want to reassure you, we will speak in English. But let me say to you and to everybody here how great our pleasure is to welcome such a distinguished and unusual audience for us, and to welcome you here in the Banque de France. It's co-hosted with Jean Pisani-Ferry and France Stratégie. Although you are internationally recognized, I will come back to that. If I'm not mistaken, it's your first conference in France, probably. And it's a project we conceived together some time ago. I am really very glad that we can realize it this evening. Your topic will be increasing prosperity with globalization, why it is still possible. We are very anxious to listen to you. And we are coming back with André Laurier and others precisely from Washington, where we spent some days discussing precisely these issues. Two very quick highlights. First, globalization has been an engine for prosperity at world level. Without any doubt, it has pulled out of poverty a significant share of humanity. If we look back at the beginning of the 80s, so a generation ago, about 44% of world population was living in a situation of extreme poverty. The ratio decreased to 13% in 2012. But we face two challenges, which we discussed deeply in Washington. Globalization has been also a source of growing inequalities within countries, be it in advanced countries or in emerging economies. And we know this gives way to a strong political debate. And second, since the end of the previous decade, this situation has been made more difficult by the ongoing slowdown in growth and productivity, both again in emerging and advanced economy. There were probably, dear Tarman, nobody more qualified than yourself to address such a hot, a topical issue. Let me say some words about your background. I could be much longer, but you are a graduate from the best universities, inter alia Cambridge and Harvard. You have spent the first part of your career as a central banker, which remains, in our view, a huge advantage, I must confess, as a central banker at the MAS, the Monetary Authority of Singapore. You served then as the Minister for Education, which you will very probably mention because it's a key priority for you, and as the Minister for Finance. You are now Deputy Prime Minister, Coordinating Minister for Economic and Social Policies of the Singapore Government, and Chairman of the Monetary Authority of Singapore. And I alluded to it, you have gained international recognition by chairing the International Monetary and Financial Committee of the IMF till 2015. So on this topic, you will give us not only a Singaporean view, which is already highly interesting given the economic journey of your country, but you will give us also an Asian and a global view. And as far as I know you, it will be a view enlightened not only by figures, but also by values. Now, dear Chairman, I give you the floor.
Governor François Villeroy, Jean Pisani-Ferry, Commissioner of France Strategy, thank you for giving me this opportunity. As François put it, to be before this distinguished and unusual audience, I think it's a real opportunity for me, real opportunity coming from the small city-state of Singapore, to be here and to talk about problems that we are all deeply concerned about today. I think we are in a very unusual time in global affairs, a time of fragility, but fragility of a very complex nature, because it is at once economic fragility, social fragility, and political fragility. Complex, each intersecting with the other, and it is creating a new mood of despondency, a loss of confidence. Economic fragility, because we've now seen a long period of stagnation of incomes in the advanced world amongst not just the lower income group, which was first affected by the initial waves of globalization and technology, but also by the middle income group, long period of income stagnation, 20 years or more in the United States, Japan, and Europe. Unemployment is stubbornly high, and youth unemployment in particular is at levels that we never could have conceived of 20 years ago, and remaining high. So that explains the understandable sense of insecurity that ordinary people feel across especially the advanced world. Social fragility, in part because of the economic insecurity, but also because social mobility is not what it was some decades ago. After the war and when nations first became independent, there was a burst of social mobility. Social mobility is now weak, almost everywhere. Most so in the United States, in fact, more in the US compared to Europe, but everywhere, it's a challenge. The sense that your children will not merely inherit your social and economic station in life, but that there can be some reshuffling on the ladder of opportunity and reshuffling on that socioeconomic ladder. That sense is now diminished. There's also a loss of sense of togetherness in society that comes about not just because of these economic and social trends, but also a new sense of discomfort, perhaps cultural dissonance in multi-ethnic societies. This too is new. It is a phenomenon that was not expected because it was a phenomenon that was not quite there when we had the first generation of immigration into Europe, into US, into the UK. But the second and third generation is now part of a society that feels different from before, on both sides. And this too is a source of social insecurity. Political fragility is itself now a concern. The increased polarization in politics, again, almost everywhere. In the United States, it takes place within the two major parties, political parties. In Europe, it takes the form of new parties on both the left and the right, taking up more space, gaining more voter share, and weakening the middle. But this weakening of the middle in politics, this weakening of the center, is a new phenomenon that has to concern us. And laid on top of this economic and social and political fragility is the overlay of geopolitical insecurity that will unfortunately be with us for many years to come. So it's a new situation, and we have to deal with it honestly and forthrightly wherever we are in the world. It is principally a problem in the advanced world, because you still have a sense of optimism in the emerging world, some sense of opportunity. The prospects of catching up are still very significant. But globalization, open economies, and the world that has provided progress for all nations cannot be sustained without a return to confidence in the advanced world. And that is why this concerns all of us. What should we do? First, we have to be clear about the causes. There are many causes, and it's very hard to disentangle the causes, be it technology or globalization or domestic policy doings or failures. The economists, I think, would conclude that technology explains the largest part of job losses that we've seen in the last 20 years or so. But globalization, too, has left people behind. It has been a significant plus for every nation. Incomes have gone up in every nation as a result of this global exchange of trade and investments, but there have been people who are left behind. And because the people left behind are not just people distributed across a nation, but are concentrated in towns and regions, that leads to a different nature of problem compared to just the statistical fact that there are some losers, but you have net gains. There are some losers, and you do have net gains, but the losers are in locations different from those who are gaining. And that, too, requires attention. It is a different nature of problem. But I think we have to conclude that the biggest differentiator between countries is not their exposure to technology or globalization. The biggest differentiator between countries is in domestic policies and institutions. The use and misuse of domestic policy is the biggest differentiator. And that is why you find that even in the advanced world, there's some countries like Sweden, which have seen significant income growth, both in the middle and at the lower end of the income ladder over the last 10 years. Better than the United States, much of the rest of Europe, and Japan. That's also why some countries have got very different educational outcomes from others. It's not because their people are naturally more talented, but it's a matter of policies and institutions. And that is also why we have different outcomes in the job market. Whether there's the ability for everyone to participate easily in the market, or you have the usual problem of protection of incumbents at the cost of new entrants, who are typically the young, women, and minorities. There are differences between countries, and these are differences that come about because of domestic policies and institutions. And we have to address these forthrightly. The societies that are doing better are not less exposed to globalization or technology. In fact, typically, they are more exposed. But it is the domestic policy response to global challenges and competition, the attempt to find a comparative advantage in our own abilities and to generate growth and jobs by competing and by being open. The domestic policy response to social issues, including the issues that come about in every multicultural society, that also distinguishes some countries from others. That is something we have to be honest about. It is the inconvenient domestic fact of globalization that differentiates some societies from others. And none of it is unchangeable. None of it is fixed for all time. These are policies that can be changed and institutions that can evolve. That has been the way it has been, and that is the way it can be, which gives us hope for the future. So there is, in all our societies, the challenge of using the domestic space we have, the domestic policy space we have, well. And that means using it to spread opportunity, using it to spread innovation, using it to enable the benefits from innovation to be felt by workers and by regions around the country, and ensuring that our domestic policy space is best used to preserve a sense of social inclusivity in our societies. And these challenges should also inspire the state. They should inspire a new ambition in the state and a new politics of the center. It is an opportunity. I will talk about three specific areas of activism on the part of the state, three specific areas of intervention that have to be part of how each of us finds our way forward in this world. The first has to do with housing and neighborhoods. The second to do with education and skills. The third to do with new industrial policies that can spread innovation more widely across our economies, spread job creation more widely, and spread the benefits of growth more widely. Housing and neighborhoods, education and skills, spreading innovation and new jobs. These are three important tasks which can reinvigorate the politics of the center. First, housing and neighborhoods. It was an issue that was always, you never study this if you're an economics undergraduate. You might sometimes study it if you're a sociology undergraduate or social work undergraduate, but it's an area which is generally neglected. Urban planning is for architects, but in fact, social urban planning is a big differentiator between cities and countries. How well we inject social policy into urban planning. And it should concern all of us. And we now, of course, appreciate that very well. France recognizes the problems, but the problems in France are not unique. In Britain, one third of Muslims live in the bottom 10% of neighborhoods by income. In other words, the most deprived neighborhoods by income levels. One third or more of Muslims live in the bottom 10%. We know the problems in the United States, Ferguson, Baltimore, Chicago. We know the problems of segregation. As bad today as it was in the 1960s, despite the achievements of the civil rights movement. So all multicultural societies have to be concerned about issues to do with where people live, who they interact with, what are the natural workings of society that come about as a result of the way in which housing, schools, and jobs are planned in a city. Critical issue. We now know from studies done especially in the United States, Raj Chetty and his collaborators have done very interesting work that finds that social mobility is shaped by where you live. After taking all other factors into account, your parents' education, the schools you go to, ethnicity, everything else taken into account, where you live also determines social mobility, because that determines who you mix with, what your aspirations are, or what ills you get caught into. It explains whether you get a cycle of aspirations or whether you get into a problem that becomes more knotty over time, where the problems get knotted together over time and get more intractable over time. Neighborhoods matter. I will, on this note, say something about Singapore, not because I intended to talk a lot about Singapore, but it's an example of city-state policies where we have placed housing and neighborhoods right in the front and center of social policy. We did so in part because we had no choice. We are a new nation, an accidental nation, multi-ethnic, in fact, the most religiously diverse country in the world, and we had to survive. We had to survive not just as an economy, but as a society, where people feel together, feel their citizens together, and have a sense of fraternity with each other. So from early in the game, we decided we had to integrate neighborhoods. But how we did it is of some interest. And although the Singapore experience, with the peculiarities of the Singapore experience, obviously can't be transported, at least not in a simple fashion, to the rest of the world, some of the principles that we have learned over time, and which I observe in some other cities, have to be principles that we all think about. First, and this may be a little unique, public housing in Singapore is 85% of total housing, but it's not public housing as is you're familiar with in most countries in Europe or the United Kingdom. It's not social housing as you know it. Our public housing resembles private condominiums and private apartment estates that you'd be more familiar with. But the state is the developer of 85% of the public of the housing, which is then sold to citizens. Now, this gives us the ability to inject social policy into the way we organize our neighborhoods. First, every neighborhood in public housing is integrated across socioeconomic groups, all the way from the poorest citizens to the upper middle income group, because it's 85% of the population. And close by, typically, is private housing, usually a little more expensive, but close by. So it's all part of one neighborhood. In my own constituency, for instance, which is a very typical constituency, working class origins, but now quite mixed. If I look at the distance in my constituency between the apartment block with the poorest residents, which is a rental block, and the apartment block with the most affluent residents in that constituency for upper middle income, it's about 100 meters. No fences, no gates, all facilities socially owned, shared. The parks, the playgrounds, the elderly facilities, the places people go to eat, everything shared. No fences, no gates. That's the first feature. The second feature, and this would be most unusual when viewed on an international scale, is ethnic integration as a matter of policy. Because of that, the historical origins, we decided early on that ethnic integration doesn't happen naturally on its own. We have to incentivize it, and we also have to have regulations that require some degree of ethnic integration. And that is why we require, even till today, that every public housing apartment block and every precinct within a neighborhood and every neighborhood as a whole has a mix of ethnicities. In other words, you can't have any one ethnicity completely dominating a block of apartments or a precinct. You must have a mix comprising the major ethnicities of Singapore in every block, in every precinct, in every neighborhood. And that was may seem intrusive, but it was done at a time when people were getting a major lift in their standard of living when they moved into public housing, because they are moving from rather poor housing, sometimes without very good sanitary conditions, into what was really rather high-quality housing. And they accepted it, they became neighbors, they became friends, their children play in the same playgrounds, and they go to the same kindergartens and schools. And society then takes over. So a regulation doesn't have to extend to what people do every day and who their friends should be. We are not that sort of society. But a regulation placed upstream within using the advantage of being public housing developer, the government, is able to then engender a form of behavior that makes interaction normal and makes a sense of comfort with each other perfectly normal. And that too has been a very important part of our strategy. But the third part of our strategy is also very important, and this is perhaps the one which is really a public policy interest everywhere, which is ownership, including ownership of apartments by the poor. We've decided early on that owning a home creates a very different ethic compared to renting a home. When you own a home and you've got a loan against the home, you usually want to keep the home, you want to stay in the job so that you can pay down your loan, and you take great pride over time in the fact that it is your home and you're in an apartment block with everyone else who also owns their homes. So when you combine the fact that these are mixed neighborhoods, mixed by socioeconomic group and mixed by ethnicity, with the fact that people own their homes, it creates a certain pride in the neighborhood. We all take care of it, and we all want to make sure it remains a good neighborhood without a broken window. But there's also another economic benefit, which I must say we didn't predict in advance. We got something very important for free, without budgetary expense, which is that when you mix people in the same neighborhood, low income all the way up, house prices tend to go up at the same rate as each other. The smallest apartments and the largest apartments tend to have roughly the same rate of home equity appreciation, price appreciation over time. And that's a very important part of financial security. The fact that you've got a home, and by the time you retire, you've got a home that's appreciated significantly in value, as long as the economy grows. But that equality of home price appreciation is something we got for free. To put it another way, we have disadvantaged people in Singapore, we have disadvantaged families, but we don't have a single disadvantaged neighborhood. And I say that not rhetorically, but as a factual matter. We do not have a single disadvantaged neighborhood because every neighborhood is mixed, every neighborhood has a certain tone about it that reflects the fact that it is mixed, and every neighborhood sees the same prosperity over time. We do not have a single disadvantaged neighborhood, and we got that for free. There's no need for constant budgetary infusion to support those with the smaller apartments. What we do, however, and this is the main expense in the budget, there's some expense as being a developer of the homes, but because we sell the homes, we're able to recoup a good part of that expense. We provide grants to the poor to make sure they can own their home, and the grants are very generous for the low-income group. So if you buy a small apartment, the grant will be over 80% of the value of the apartment. But it's far better to give that grant and to create that sense of pride in the home and that incentive to stay in the job than it is to have a continuous stream of subsidies applied in some other fashion. But the other part of the budget that's involved is the rejuvenation of the neighborhood as a whole, which does involve the state. As neighborhoods get older, we rejuvenate them. Every year, we upgrade every neighborhood, the playgrounds, creating new features, something new for the elderly, new types of exercise machines, every year. And every 10 or 15 years, we do a major upgrade to make sure that nothing becomes old and dilapidated. And that's the budgetary expense. But the total cost of all this is less than 1% of GDP. Because we're a developer, we sell the flats, we then give targeted subsidies to the poor, and we do some rejuvenation of the estates. And we get something for free, which is social integration and an equal appreciation of home equity. It's quite different from a model of subsidizing rentals for a broad segment of the population, which some countries have, broad segment of the lower half of the population. There are many problems to do with that because it's very hard to prevent the rentals from ultimately going towards the profits of private developers. So it's a different model, and I say this because this has been so important to Singapore. It's really the secret sauce of Singapore. But there are some principles involved in it that I think are worth thinking about as we look at other cities. Next, education. And we all know how important that is. We have to now try our very best, whatever legacies we have, to develop the potential of every child, no matter what their starting point. And in particular, to reduce the disparities in performance that come about because of who your parents are, your socioeconomic background. We've got to try much harder to tackle these problems. And they're not getting easier because society is changing. We have what's called assortative mating, which is that the most educated men and women tend to get married to each other, which wasn't the case historically, but it is the case now. And that tends to mean that what children receive from their parents is now different from before. So the challenges of social mobility are greater, and it means we have to work harder at it. The OECD has done major work on this because they collect a lot of data each year through the PISA project, a wealth of data. And they do, in fact, do very interesting analysis about the influence of social backgrounds on educational attainments. I think in France there's a debate that has taken place because of this. You're well aware of the problem because France is not an underperformer in terms of overall levels of attainment. I mean, you're not an outperformer, but you're somewhere fairly near the average for OECD countries. But France has one of the highest degrees of what's called social determination, where your social background influences your attainment. One of the highest amongst the OECD countries, where your background shapes your attainment. Overall attainment, roughly average, but the slope is quite different. Very high performers at one end, but very low performers at the other. And I know that successive governments have been concerned about this. You're going about the redesign of priority education, some important initiatives to try to make secondary schools less equal. But this is a challenge everywhere. It's a challenge, and we want to do something more to help the individual, the family, and to strengthen our societies. I will mention three issues in this regard. The first is uncontentious, and I'll say it very briefly. The earlier we intervene, the better. In fact, starting from the prenatal period, the earlier we intervene, the better. And early childhood education, everyone now agrees, is critical in redressing the imbalances that are there early in life, the lottery of birth, as some people put it. We have to do more to deliver quality early childhood education across the board because it helps those who have a weaker start the most. And in this regard, France does a relatively good job compared to most other countries. You have a quality childcare sector, universal, affordable, and it is one of the examples that we all look towards. But schools are a big differentiator, and this is where there are major issues. There are two key issues I will highlight in this regard, and they address not just debates that are taking place in France, but everywhere. First, there is a tension that we all face in educational policy between uniformity and differentiation. It's an inherent tension in education and a meaningful tension. How uniform should education be and for how long? And how differentiated should it be to cater to different abilities and different pieces of learning? The Simple reasoning often is that if you want to be egalitarian, if you want equality, you should go for a uniform school system for as long as you can, for as many years as possible, a uniform curriculum, uniform pace of teaching across all schools and for everyone. That is a simple, intuitive way of thinking about it. It seems more egalitarian. But in fact, what we have found across a range of countries, and including France, is that that method of egalitarianism that takes the form of uniformity can lead to very inegalitarian outcomes. In particular, a very large dropout rate of students, either along the way or when they finally leave high school or upper secondary school, without any qualifications. That's not an egalitarian outcome, but it comes about because of uniformity. So we have to think more deeply about what it means to be egalitarian and what it truly means to have equality in education. And I believe that it must mean that we recognize the strengths in each student, their different abilities, recognize that in every population, there are some people who learn better along an academic mode of learning, and some people who learn better along a practice-based model of learning. And these habits and these strengths also evolve over time. They're not fixed for all time. But that would be an educational strategy that is sensitive to the individual and that truly wants to develop the potential of every individual. That, to my mind, is also egalitarian, but it requires some rethinking. We have many examples around the world of how this is done. In Europe, the Swiss are one of the foremost examples. At age 15, 70% of Swiss kids pursue a vocational path. And Switzerland has one of the best regarded educational systems in the world and also one of the most advanced economies in the world. In Singapore, we differentiate starting from age 13, not as radically as the Swiss, by having a very large group going down the vocational path. We have a broadly academic curriculum, but a different type of academic curriculum for different groups of students. And I would add that if you look at the PISA results, although Singapore ends up at the near the top of the table for most of our students, what is most interesting to me is that the gap between Singapore and other countries in performance is extremely wide when you look at our weakest students in Singapore. Our weakest students measured by PISA competencies outperform the weakest students in other countries by a very large margin. And this could not have come about if we had imposed a uniform education, a uniform curriculum on every student. It could not have come about. And I believe it is fairer and ultimately more egalitarian. However, we have to make sure that any differentiation in education comes with flexibility, flexibility of pathways. So you're never stuck on one path forever. And there are no dead ends on any path. We need a porosity between different streams in education so that even in a person's mind, in the mind of the teacher and the student, there is that porosity. I'm not simply consigned to one path. I might move to another path later on, but I want to develop as much as well as I can while I'm on this path. And that porosity is very important in mitigating some of the downsides of differentiation, because there are downsides in your self-concept, in your sense of ambition. There are possible downsides, but they can be mitigated by having flexibility and porosity and making sure that we have never have dead ends along any pathway. And further, we have to, as much as we can, to ensure that we still preserve social mixing, so that even if you're differentiating education for different groups based on their abilities at that point in time, we try to have them in the same school. So that there's a whole range of activities they still do together. Their football, their netball, their basketball, their plays and drama, and often common classes for certain subjects. So maximize social mixing rather than segregate them entirely. So we have to differentiate to some extent in order to develop the potential of every child, which should be an egalitarian ideal. But we have to do it in a way that minimizes the downsides, maximizes the upsides, but minimizes the downsides. And there's a very important space in educational policy that we have to use to achieve that. The second point about schools I want to make, and I'm talking at some length on education, as Francois expected, the second point is even more important, which is that the most important way we can spread quality across schools is in fact through the expertise of teachers, and teachers with quality teachers distributed across our system. It is far more important than the structure of our systems. If you look, for instance, at Singapore and Finland, and I chose those two because I just noticed that there was a World Economic Forum survey that had Singapore and Finland rated at the top for educational systems. But we, in fact, have quite different school systems, Singapore and Finland. The Finns differentiate their students much later than we do. They've got a different structure. But we do have something in common. We place great emphasis on recruiting, retaining, and developing quality teachers. That is central to our whole school system. Some parts seem obvious, recruiting good people, rewarding them well, which we do in Singapore. We reward our teachers well, including performance-based pay, which is true for all other professions. That's applied in teaching as well, performance-based pay. But there's some other parts which are also very important, which is how you distribute teachers across schools. And we make it a point to distribute teachers based on the needs of the school. If a school has got additional challenges, it deserves more teachers, so it can have some smaller classes, it can have pull-out sessions, or some special programs. That too is important. And very importantly, we also keep moving our head teachers or principals around the entire system. Every principal of a school moves every 5 to 7 years. They become principals much earlier than in many other countries. In Singapore, because of a performance-based system, we groom the best teachers, if they have the administrative capabilities as well, to become principals relatively early in their careers, typically between their late 30s and mid-40s, at the very latest by their late 40s. But they move throughout their careers. If you're doing a good job in this school, good. Please do it in another school. If you're not doing such a good job, perhaps you need a change of environment. But we keep moving our teachers and principals around, especially the senior people. And that is how quality evens out across the system. It's an extremely important feature. Education is about people. It's about our teachers. How they guide students, how they get them to question themselves, how they get them to think critically. The teacher is critical. Children do not on their own do it. A teacher with the confidence of knowledge of his or her subject and with that pedagogic ability to bring out the best in the children is critical. And how we distribute teachers across the system is absolutely critical. And when you combine that with homes and neighborhoods, that combination of mixed and integrated homes and neighborhoods with quality distributed across the school system is really the most important combination of social and economic policies in Singapore. Tertiary education also requires some comment. It's a challenge everywhere because we have to face up to the fact that there's a large mismatch of skills that are being developed through education, including tertiary education, and the demands of the marketplace. There's a very large mismatch of skills. There's a very large number of jobs that are going vacant because of a lack of skills, and there's a large oversupply of college graduates all over the world. It's true in the United States, it's true in Britain, it's true in Europe, it's even true in China and India, where the graduate unemployment rates are well over 10%. We have to address that forthrightly and get a better mix of theory and practicality, a mix of academic and real-world learning into tertiary education, so as to better develop the potential of individuals and better meet the needs of the marketplace. It's a fundamental issue. And free entry, which has a great egalitarian appeal, is not all what it seems to be. I know in France about the chainsaw massacre that happens after the first year of university. A former French education minister, when I asked him why you have the system of free entry and then a very large number leaving after the first year, told me, well, you know, the French like philosophy. It doesn't matter what the outcome is, but the philosophy of equality is extremely important. I think now France recognizes this as an issue, just like all of us do. We've got to gear education to the needs of the market and to help people truly develop their potential in life. Finally, I'm going to skip, by the way, a whole section of my speech because we're running out of time, but I want to go on to a very important issue, which is that education has to be stretched throughout life. Learning has to take place throughout life, and this has to be a whole new priority in economic and social policy. We cannot front-load education the way we used to the first 18 or 22 years of a person's life. It is clearly unfit, doesn't fit people out well for the real world, and it's a real world where skills keep being churned, and new skills are required, whatever the job, whatever the industry. It is not possible for the old structures of education to produce the skills that you need through life. And it's not possible just to develop a learning ability when you're young and expect that individuals can somehow keep picking up skills on their own as they go along. We need an injection of skills throughout life at regular intervals in a person's career. And this requires a new form of public-private collaboration, a new form of distributing our fiscal resources, and it has to be new methods of education as well, which are themselves very exciting. The ability to modularize learning, bite-sized learning relevant to the market, the ability to stack up modular learning so that people can get certification over time that's relevant to employers, and the ability to move towards learning that people feel they are in charge of as individuals, not just a university that designs a course, and not just the employer, but that they are in charge of. And I think France's individual learning account, I think you call it the CPF system, which we have also recently introduced in Singapore through what we call a skills future credit given to everyone, every citizen, in our case above the age of 25, your case above 16, is a very important way of empowering citizens to shape their own learning through life. And that, too, is a very important new direction in education. I will skip a section that I was going to talk about, which has to do with new industrial policies and how we have to spread the gains that are being made at the frontier of each industry to the rest of that industry, because that has been a growing gap around the world, in the US, in Europe, and everywhere. The growing gap in productivity levels between the firms at the frontier and the rest. And it is a source of low productivity growth, but also a source of inequality. In fact, the most important source of inequality is inequality in wages between firms. And we have to address that forthrightly through new industrial policies that strengthen clusters, strengthen the relationship between the leading firms and the rest, between the large and the small. And I know you've adopted some very interesting strategies in France, your competitive clusters and your industries of the future, which are already seeing very important results in Lyon and elsewhere. We too are embarked on this strategy. We call it industry transformation maps, systematic ways in which we help spread innovation from the leaders to the rest, enhance collaboration within a supply chain, and boost skills of the workers involved in each of these industries at the same time. It is inspiring a new type of social partnership, which I have to mention, which is different from the traditional business-labor partnership, which was focused on wage bargaining and wage settlement. The new partnership, in our case it's tripartisan because it involves business, labor, and government, is focused on skills, productivity enhancement, and new jobs. And our unions are active participants in this business of developing new skills, working with employers to raise productivity, and then ensuring that there's fair sharing of productivity gains. It is a new social partnership, focused not just on dividing up what exists, but focused on creating new jobs, enhancing productivity, and growing together. And I feel that too offers a lot of potential in the broader partnerships that we're talking about. Finally, politics. I spoke at the start about the fragilities that we are facing, economic, social, political. The policies I've spoken about so far are examples of economic and social policies, housing, education, spreading productivity gains throughout a sector and throughout an economy. But politics is critical. And we now face not just a risk, but a reality of populism in virtually every advanced democracy. It is a reality on both the left and the right of a new populism. And perhaps equally worrying, we are also seeing the pillars of democracy, the parties of the center, now chasing the shadows of populism as a survival strategy. And this is itself a threat to democracy and a threat to achieving inclusive prosperity. We have to reinforce the politics of the center, and I believe it can be done. I believe we can defeat populism by truth, by being near to the people and explaining to them what the facts are, how they're going to gain, who's going to lose, and how we're going to help those who lose, recognize their insecurities, but provide them hope in the future, which we can. And by being honest, by being close to the people, we have to reinvigorate the politics of the center. Our economic and social strategies, of course, are fundamental. If they don't work, no politics of the center can work. But politics too is important. What we say, how we interact with people, and how we give people confidence, the confidence they used to have, that whether it's a center-left or center-right government, there are certain basic values that are going to keep us going. And those are values of collective responsibility and values of personal responsibility. It may require us to go back to the values that were there at the inception of both social democracy and the social market economy, both the center-left and center-right. Their values were very similar. They involved individual responsibility for education, for work, for your family, but they involved collective responsibility so that everyone is protected from the vagaries of the marketplace. Those original values and norms have evolved over time. There's been some loss of personal responsibility, but they have to evolve again for us to reignite this sense that we're in it together, but we all play our own part in contributing to this better future. And that's the challenge we all face, wherever we are. So thank you very much for your patience. I'm sorry I've spoken for a little longer than expected, but education is always like that. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Tarman. We have listened to you not only with great interest, but probably with something which is still stronger, with hope. And we could have listened to you probably for twice as long, including on education and industrial policy, but thank you for keeping a bit time for questions. Two rules of the games: everything is on the record in this conference, and we agreed on that. And I say hello to the journalists who are here.
Et deuxièmement, je redis, n'hésitez pas à poser des questions en français, si vous le souhaitez. Si on peut d'ailleurs avoir un translating kit for Tarman, if necessary. So, you have one. So, please don't hesitate. We have about 15 to 20 minutes for your questions, if you can only introduce yourself. Jean.
Formula for doing it. Sorry. I think from now on we will be saying how to get to Singapore. And really, you ended with this political conditions for achieving what you said, which is essentially social investment, right? I mean, what we call social investment, and you gave us a program for social investment. Now, how can it be made sustainable? How can it be made acceptable by the population? I mean, it's probably easier in a city-state than in a large country where geography, as you said at the start, is increasingly divided, dividing communities. But still, how do you make it politically sustainable?
I think that's obviously a very important question. You all start from a legacy. And we have to tackle legacies at the same time that we provide hope in the future. Larger societies and societies with a long history typically don't have the same sense of urgency as small societies that face existential crises, which is what Singapore had. You don't have an existential problem. India doesn't have an existential problem. But there is a sense in which whichever society we're in, the longer we wait, the more complicated the problems are going to be, because they're not economic problems. In economics, there's a reversion to the mean. Every MBA student learns that, every economic student learns that. If you have an overvalued stock, the value will eventually come down. If you have demand exceeding supply, prices will adjust and things will equilibrate. Society doesn't equilibrate. There's no reversion to the mean. Social norms and values tend to continue on the same trajectory, multiplying, and the problems get more intractable. There is no reversion to the mean. And that means that wherever we are and whatever our legacies, we have to act with a certain urgency of the center to start acting before it gets even worse. In housing, that involves physical constraints, so the legacy is very serious. And it's not just France, actually, it's in many places. But there are regulations, if I talk about the United States, there are regulations that make segregation worse, and there are ways of changing those regulations. There are ways in which reinvigoration of existing neighborhoods can be done in a way that's economically sustainable by involving the private sector. I don't want to go into at length into this, but pilot neighborhoods and pilot cities often demonstrate to the rest what is achievable.
Questions here to the audience? Mathieu?
So Mathieu,
each of you has a microphone.
Mathieu Bussière from the Banque de France. Thank you so much for your presentation. I found it absolutely fascinating to hear from you about the experience of Singapore, which I didn't know about. My first question would be, among the solutions that you have proposed, how confident are you that they can be transposed from Singapore, which is a fairly young nation, into older countries like France and or Italy in Europe? And in particular, regarding the first item of your presentation, which is urban planning. And just to give an example, a few months ago, there was a study on the city of Florence in Italy that showed that in Florence, the families that were rich during the Renaissance, so 500 years ago, are still the richest now. And so the question would be, how can we transpose the experience of Singapore into our countries? And my second question would be, when we think about globalization, we think of trade openness, financial account openness, migrations. And in your presentation, and something that I found very refreshing, you discussed policies which at first sight are not directly related with this. So it's education, urban planning, social policy. Does that mean that your advice would be not to mitigate or to compromise with globalization as such, but addressing the consequences of globalization? Or do you have another message on globalization? Thank you.
So two excellent questions. I'll answer the second one first because it's a broader question. We have not exploited what is possible in domestic policies to help those who are displaced by either technology or globalization. Most societies haven't done all that can be done, and there's been a large gulf between what is being done and what should be done. It's true in the US, it's true in Europe, it's true in most societies. I think we have to take very seriously what now has to be understood, which is that the market doesn't solve these problems on its own. The market doesn't help someone who's displaced to get back into a job easily. What happens more often is employers view someone displaced as someone who's unemployed, prefers to take someone who's already got a job somewhere else and poach them directly from another firm. And once you're unemployed for some period of time, what the economists call hysteresis sets in. There are inherent difficulties getting back into a job if you're left on your own. The assistance of the state working with employers, working with unions, can be extremely effective. And we have to do that aggressively. The problems to do with housing are more intractable, but I think some societies have found ways in which you can reinvigorate neighborhoods which appear to be disadvantaged and appear to be neighborhoods where problems multiply amongst themselves. It typically involves the private sector, but it involves a public incentive. And the incentive in terms of the regulatory requirements that are placed on housing development, the incentive in terms of tax breaks, the various incentives that are required, because the state itself is not going to have the fiscal resources to be able to acquire larger estates and redevelop them. So we have to be creative about it. There's some interesting experiments taking place in the United States, by the way, but no legacy is unshakable. And the main point which I made earlier is that if we don't start now, the problems are going to get much more serious. So we're not doing all we should to offset the negatives of globalization. Let's be clear about that.
Yeah, sorry. Ça marche?
He was just trying to save energy.
But we have heard.
That's a very good question. I'll give you a quick answer, which is that even in terms of what I was talking about, environmental sustainability is an issue. Because when we think of neighborhoods, what is it that makes it an attractive neighborhood? It isn't just what's inside my apartment. It's the greenery, it's the parks, it's the lake. Is the lake looking brown or is it looking blue? These things matter to ordinary citizens. Do they have a feeling of calm when they walk home every day back to their apartments? That shared public good that is about environmental friendliness, that is about the greenery, is important even from the point of view of social cohesion. So even in terms of what I was talking about, not just in terms of environmental goals, it is important. And it so happens that good things are good for many things. If you do the right thing for environmental sustainability, it helps in terms of health, it helps in terms of people's sense of well-being, and it helps in terms of making a neighborhood a very nice place to live. And the environment is one of these no-regret issues if we do it well. So we're trying our best in Singapore, as you mentioned, through power, through our transport rules, which are not many countries do it, but we charge for congestion on all our roads automatically. You have a card in your car and automatically deduct a charge when you go through a congested road. Everything we're trying to do to reduce carbon emissions. And then, of course, we have some challenges of industries, which are global industries, which are carbon emitters. And we have to decide how we balance that against our overall carbon emission targets.
Yeah.
Filippo Di Mauro, actually at ACB, but now, fortunately, at the National University of Singapore. Minister, as usual, very modest in telling us what Singapore has done. But maybe you forgot to tell us, because you're very modest, that actually you are one of the most popular government in the world, in the elected world. So I was wondering if you have, and you have delivered a society which is extremely harmonic. This is something that I would stress. So it's not only social welfare, thinking about carefully about your program, but also have delivered something that is extremely harmonic. So I was wondering if in this circumstance you can have a couple of advice to give to our political system, which is actually apparently unable to communicate maybe these views. I mean, what is your secret in actually maintaining this popularity? Because this is, of course, you have strategy, but you must have some extra.
Well, first, by the way, let me take that opportunity of Filippo asking this question to say that he and his colleagues at the OECD are the ones who've done this very interesting work on productivity to show that the firms at the frontier are not only having higher levels of productivity, but growing productivity at a very different rate from the rest of the economy. And diffusion is not taking place the way it used to. It's really excellent work that you've done.
We did it at the ECB as well. And the Eurosystem actually was included in the Banque de France.
Well, you know who's paying for the decision. I'm not in a position to give advice to politicians in other countries, particularly countries which are larger and face more complex challenges. But I would just make one point. One advantage we have of having the British parliamentary system is that everyone has his own constituency, his or her own constituency. I'm only a minister because I'm elected in a constituency. And it brings you down to earth very quickly because you have to interact very often with a whole range of people, all segments of the population, and you have to understand what their concerns are. You can't be dismissive of it because then they will dismiss you. You have to devise solutions which you would not have been taught about as a bureaucrat or as an intellectual. And I have found that really enriching. The only thing I'll say is it involves hard work and you must enjoy it. If you don't enjoy it, it's better to be a technocrat or be a professional and contribute to commissions and write papers. But you must enjoy politics. If you don't enjoy politics, it's tough work that'll be draining on you. And I think there's a virtuous cycle when you get people entering politics because they actually like interacting and serving people. And then people realize, well, look, sometimes they get their policies wrong, but this is a guy who cares about me. He or she cares about me, and I'm going to give them a chance. We've made mistakes as well in Singapore. And I don't take our current majority as a given at all. We have a very intelligent electorate, and it's capable of choosing someone else the moment they get a party that comes up with a better strategy. And if we lose our track record, If we lose our track record or we turn corrupt, we've lost it.
If
sorry. Yes, please. It will be the last.
Thank you very much for this very interesting speech that provides us with much hope. You spoke about integrating different kinds of community with neighborhood and education, but how this kind of integration can be resilient to the aging of the Singapore society with this diamond-shaped pyramid of age. And well, this is an interesting thing for us, which are also aging societies. Thank you.
It's a very good question. And that's a whole dimension of social policy that is becoming very important in Singapore. In fact, the biggest challenge is in healthcare. It's the biggest fiscal or budgetary challenge, but it's also a biggest challenge for our population because the costs of healthcare are going up everywhere in the world. And one of the main strategies for dealing with this problem in a way that also enhances the quality of care is to take healthcare out of hospitals, into the community, and even into the home. The technologies now make this possible, but it's a new form of community activity as well in the neighborhood that involves professionals, paramedical staff. They may not be fully trained nurses all the time, but they're able to help residents in some things. And volunteers, including volunteers who are themselves retired or older in years. So it's a new form of civil society activity that has to grow in our neighborhoods, taking care of each other, having the expertise and support of the hospitals and the clinics. But it's a way that links up with what I was talking about earlier, which is that the shared public goods in the neighborhood will increasingly be about taking care of the elderly and enabling them to have active lives.
I think it belongs to me to, not really to conclude, but to perhaps to say a few words. I would have liked to ask the former Minister of Finance what the cost of all that, because I think you presented the philosophy, the policies, and the question for a country like us is the strategy of investment an alternative and a better alternative to the strategy of repair we have, or the politics of repair we have in place. I mean, we tend to believe that the social model is a social insurance, is a social repair model. And you essentially presented us a different view, which actually goes perhaps to the roots of what was in the long past the philosophy of the French social model, giving access to education, giving access to housing, giving access to the labor market, all that which are really the precondition of a functioning society. The problem we are facing now is that we've moved away in large part from success in these fields, and we have attempted to solve the problem by pouring money in a more sort of a repair approach of the problems. And this raises questions of sustainability, this raises question of acceptability. We're becoming, instead of getting to Singapore, we're getting a bit to the US, where social assistance is increasingly criticized for benefiting a certain segment of society and from those who feel they're paying for it. The sort of the glue of solidarity is not disappearing, but is diminishing its power. It is diminishing. So the big question, and I think we can learn a lot, and it's very important to learn from the successful experience that you have described. It's very important to see how far one can go as regards the housing. We did not discuss so much the housing, but the housing was absolutely fascinating because it's so far from the situation we're facing and schools also. I think it's very important to learn that you can make progress in this direction, and it pays off. Now, What remained is how to translate that into a strategy that will help us achieve, I mean, invest without losing what we have at present. And that's an economic, social, and political challenge.
I'll just add one word to what you said. From a fiscal point of view, it is, as you are implying, always cheaper to do something upstream instead of downstream. If you do something right upstream, be it regulation or an investment, it creates a stream of behavior that leads to much lesser problems downstream. The downstream is always expensive. In every area of social policy, you called it repair, it's always expensive. Secondly, I would just make the point that we may be at the other end of the spectrum from you, but there's a whole range along the spectrum that now involves targeted subsidies for people, whether it's in healthcare or education or many other areas. And I think there's a growing awareness that universal subsidies or flat benefits actually are not very egalitarian, not very progressive, because they tend to benefit the upper middle income group the most, the middle and upper income group the most. The rich will hopefully pay their taxes, but the middle class is the one that knows how to take the best advantage of universal benefits, including free university.
So thank you very much. Again, we could have stayed for the all night. I suggest we take some time now for a cocktail, un pot, etc. Et nous serons très heureux que vous puissiez rester avec nous encore quelques minutes. Merci encore d'être venu ce soir à la Banque de France. Merci à France Stratégie. And thank you so much to you, Tarman.